So we'll begin by introducing ourselves. This is Casey. This is Soumya, Harendra, Netrika, me, Avnish, and we have also two team members, Hina and Arpita. So the topic that we have chosen for our discussion is social infrastructure, employment, and human development. We know that the government is spending quite a lot of amount of percent of GDP, almost 6% consistently in social infrastructure, but still there is a divide that exists in India. We have an India that is Bharat and another part is India, right? So in order to bring about inclusive development and development that is sustainable over a period of time, we need to have the social infrastructure base strong enough to sustain it.
Yes.
And education will form the base of it. So let's start with the education sector first.
So as Avnish talked about the gap between Bharat and India, this gap can be bridged only with education, as he said. So if I talk about the demographic dividend, which is the economically active population, that is age between 15 to 59, that has increased drastically, which was 53% in 1971, it has increased to 63%. And education is the thing that will make the skilled population, working population. So education has to be come upon.
Yeah, so there are various indexes which measure the quality of education in India. And if you look like there is one student classroom ratio, and there is no fixed limit to this, but the ideal size is assumed to be around 30. So it is shown that it has declined from 43% in 2009 to 10 to 25% in 2015 to 16. So obviously there has been a quantitative betterment, but one needs to look at the qualitative factors also. I mean the teacher's quality, the amount of education he possesses, the skill to keep the classroom intact and participative. Even these factors come, and sadly, India is what is missing in the nowadays.
Just adding to your point, I want to mention a few more indicators. Like we have quantitative, like enrollment to level, and we have completion rate, and as well as we need to consider about the construction of the building as well, and we have qualitative indicators like learning outcomes and assessment standards. So we need to consider qualitative as well as quantitative to strike a balance between both of them and to make and to build upon this thing.
Yeah, and to achieve that education and what our government actually has taken steps. It has taken steps like sustainable development goal, which plans to achieve universalization of elementary education. And also we have Right to Education Act, which is recently enacted in 2009, which says that children between 6 to 14 has free and compulsory admission, attendance and completion of elementary education. So our government has taken steps towards educating everyone, towards educating India.
So as Casey is talking about those steps, I would want to add on to it. That is one act that came was RTE Act in 2009. It was free education at elementary level. It was the government came up with this scheme for to increase the quality of education and the accessibility that the rural people and the other students need to the education. Apart from that, there is also SSA, that is Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan. Because still the standard of education, as Soumya was talking about, the qualitative aspects of education, there is a compromise that these students are making. So the quality of education depends on the type of teachers. And if teachers and the student teacher ratio, if that is not up to the mark, we will not be able to impart that knowledge in the students itself. So that is to be kept in mind.
Yeah, a lot of indicators are coming up, right? We have the teachers people ratio. So not only the students that are there, we also have to talk about the teachers who are teaching them, right? So teachers training also becomes an important part of it. We have also seen that now there is a push towards Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, right? So that is an important factor, because now women are, in order to get women to the higher pedestals, it's very important that the push comes from the elementary sector where they begin their education as well, right? So yeah. The literacy rate that exists in India, there is a gap between the male and the female. And
I would like to shed some light on Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao. It actually is it's a mass campaign, as you said, targeted towards creating awareness. And it actually was launched in 2015, and it was under three ministries, namely Ministries of Women and Child Development, health and family welfare, and human resources development. So this, since it's taken by three ministries, we can clearly see that this is very important.
Just to add on to it, we have a gender parity index for measurement of women education as well. Actually, gender parity index reflects discrimination against girls in access to education opportunities. So it is still prevalent in higher education, but we need to consider it on the elementary level also. So yeah, we need to build more schemes like this.
We see that there are a lot of schemes like Vidya Means that the government has started to keep children in the elementary level of education, because you know what happens, that if you don't have food, you don't have proper food, obviously education is a second thing, right? So in order to promote that, that scheme is helping government to push through, at least keep people to the elementary level. But in order to put them to the higher levels of education, it's very essential that some type of structure is brought about in the course so that it channelizes to keep people in education.
Yes, and one more thing. We have SSA and RMSA. Like, if we complement all these things together, I think they can, you know, give a productive outcome.
Yes.
Educated section of this of the society, and which will in turn benefit the economy.
One thing I would like to add is, as you all mentioned, there are various schemes which have been launched by the government. One of the factors which I find the government is defaulting is that it has also introduced many schools and many schemes, such as midday schemes, but it is lacking on the sanitation facilities, the basic security for the girl child. There are lesser or more number of toilets, not only for girls, but for men. Yeah, so these, now if I'm a parent and I'm of I'm poor, but I don't have, I want to send my girl child, the first thing I will ensure is her safety. And if that is the thing I can't compromise on, so I think the government should find out which of the policies it has created should be implemented in a, such a manner that it is able to involve mass participation.
Yeah, the schools are in with that. They have very good infrastructure, but we will see the skewness also there existing with the public sector schools. Many of them not having the basic infrastructure to cater to that large section of population that we are seeing, right? And the private sector schools that we have, the amount of money that they require for to facilitate education is not something that out of reach of the Bharat that we're talking about. And that's where the divide starts at the basic level.
Yeah, as Soumya talked about the girl child not being educated enough, and the sanitation and the toilet facilities, that is one reason of the girl child taking the dropouts from the school itself. The elementary or the basic knowledge that the individual must have, the girls never reach to that level because they drop out at that point itself. So that is to be kept in mind also, not just talking about the girl child, the basic elementary level education, that is reading something, or the basic mathematics, two digit mathematics, and that is also lacking. The infrastructure that includes library and drinking water facility, that's all lacking in the system. So that is to be kept in mind.
So this is how education obviously translates into the higher domains of things, and involvement, right? So the basic education will obviously form how you're going to form your life. We're also seeing that now India, though it has a very huge young population, right? But how it transforms into a dividend or a liability will depend upon how quality of education that they're going to provide to the generations to come up, right? So let's talk about more about the employment and how the education level is transforming into itself into employment.
Just I want to mention one point, like presently the expenditure of by the government of India in education sector is just about 2.4% of the GDP. So we need to increase that up to around 4 to 5%, so that we can be more productive in this section also, and we can build up on it and to make our generation next future good as well.
So as we are talking about the employment and how education should translate itself into employment, so we need, for the demographic dividend, we need skilled people, the skilled workforce, and for that the literacy levels are not up to the mark. As well as if we talk about the basic level of education, if we want employment, that level of education should be reached. So the basis of the pyramid is not strong enough. So if we talk about the literacy rates, it is 73% literacy rate of India as per the census of 2011. When it comes to male, it is 80.9%, and for the females, it's 64.9%. 0.6%. So there is this much of gap between male and female incels here also. And
yeah, just so to pick up on a point, we also we find that this also translates how women join the workforce. So when there is a disparity at the basic education level and how it grows up with the wife, you'll see that in the, when women are joining the workforce and they are getting employed, so the more it is skewed towards the male section of the society, right? But the government is also taking initiatives to promote not only skill education and education, but also skilled labor force. And that's where the voluntary training thing comes up, because you know, you see that people who are not men, I mean, who are dropouts of after 12, they need to be trained in, they have people in government to be able to cater to their family so that their children are able to study and move to the value chain, right?
Okay, and as Nitika mentioned earlier, that there is already a literacy down rate in our country, and on top of it, earlier 10 years back we had heard about brain drain. That meant that the quality of the talent used to go out of the country. And that was the era of Barack Obama. Now with Trump having come into US, now there's a new trend which many political activists believe is what is called as protectionism. So I believe that that may be in some ways good to India, because then we have the quality of the talent going back to the country and serving the country. And recently the government has also launched a scheme called Mahila Yehat, where it plans to use of technology to upgrade the skill level of women workforce. And as you see, they continue 49% of the population. So when we have when we don't have 49% of the population contributing to that level, then we can see a drop in our GDP.
Yeah, absolutely.
When it comes to employment, there was also a scheme, MNREGA 2005. It was Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, which provided 100 days of guaranteed employment. So it is a scheme that provided them employment, but this is on a temporary basis. What about the rest of the days of the year? If they are providing only 100 days, they would work for that much time and they won't get that much of wages itself. So apart from that,
we have to also see the fact that MGNREGA provided for only the unskilled labor force. Yeah, because yeah, but in order to translate that to the skilled labor force, let's talk more about the skilled labor force. Yeah? Government is setting up the industry training institutes. Government is has a set of program, Skill India program, right? The Skill India Mission, right? Yeah, National Skill Development Council also exists to promote the, and it's a privately managed.
Even they are introducing new schemes on digital platform also, like we have a Shram Suvidha portal, we have a unified account number, and we have National Career Service portal as well. So they are introducing new jobs for job seekers, as well as they are providing trainings and workshops for them. And there are few programs which are related to their skill development as well. So yes, government is presently focusing on that area, but we also need to see the other part of it. Like we have labor reforms around, there are around 38 central labor reforms and laws which are being categorized into four categories. Like the first one is the code on wages, the second one is safety and working conditions, the third one is industrial relation, and we have the fourth one is security. Security and welfare of the employee.
One thing I would like to add is that around the recent government, BJP government, it has been trying to promote various startups in India. So recently the entrepreneurs were very overjoyed at the thought that the government is trying to push with having various tax benefits for everyone and all. But if you look at the reality, if you go on net, you find out that on budding entrepreneurs, they are having one complaint that the policies are not implemented very well. I need to say that they are not the tax and subsidies which are being given out to them have been curtailed or have been restricted, and on the top of it they are having GST which has created certainty, and now even that certainty could go. But I believe that all these factors should have been well thought of, well cared of, and should have been implemented in a better manner.
Yeah, so you're talking about the enabling factor of the government, where the government legislation itself sometimes are preventing them from
creating a positive environment.
I would like to say that the government who takes steps to all these things. For example, I would like to say the Employee State Insurance Act, which is extended across 325 complete districts and 93 district headquarters, which basically says that the insured person has the cash benefits in case of absence due to sickness, temporary or permanent, disablement, and moreover, dependent benefit. So we must have seen that the dependent of a government employee, we happen, they get treated in a hospital or you know something like that. So the government does take steps like I would like to present a fact that as of 31st of 2017 March, this employee's state insurance had covered 3.1 crore from the employees, and the dependent benefit amounts up to 12.40 crore. So the government has done a lot.
Those statistics clearly bring about the attempt that the government is making, but we also see that there is a lacking factor that exists at the education level, at the basic education level, and how they divide itself, channelize itself into the informal sector, and how the women, they are moving up the value chain, and also the whole labor force as a part of skilled labor force that we have was much lacking on the quality that we need as of in this era of industrialization.
Yeah, I would like to add one point. As you said, that employability will only increase if educational quality increases, and it will, the education quality will increase if more and more students are being getting the higher education that they require. And if they are not educated, if they are uneducated, they will land up in the unorganized sector and they will be exploited in that. So there is no formal acts to govern the unorganized sector. So that is really important that they are educated so they don't get exploited also. That's also another point.
Yeah, there are actually a lot of NGOs and also the government has a scholarship scheme, the national scholarship scheme, through which the government is promoting the children who are at the lower side of the society to have access to the higher education, especially the brighter ones from the government.
Yeah.
So I'll be talking about the Health for All initiative by the Indian government in the economic survey this year. So we know that the recently Niti Aayog report says that Kerala tops the Niti Aayog health index, whereas UP is a state which is lagging behind in the terms of health. So we must also consider the fact that India hosts 1/5 of the world's population and most of it is in the unorganized sector. So we need to look at the issues which are known as popularly known as WASH, which is water, sanitation and health. And so government has recently launched a national health policy in 2017 in this survey, which says that we need to strengthen our health delivery systems and we need to have a more coverage as far as health is concerned, especially in the village areas. So health is an issue where the government has launched a couple of schemes. So before moving on to schemes, as we have discussed a lot of things related to education, we must also understand the role of private and the government sector as far as health is concerned. So the current health expenditure says that 23% of health expenditure is spent by the private entities, whereas only 29% shows that government and private both are involved. So that's why government has taken various measures to improve this number. And so to address this issue, we have National Health Mission, which says that we need to provide incentives to people. So for example, there are two schemes, National Free Diagnostic Service Initiative, which gives approximately 760 crore of the budget to provide free diagnostic services in public health sector. Apart from that, we have National Free Drug Initiative. So herein, government has proposed to provide free drugs for various diseases and ailments like AIDS and tuberculosis and dengue nowadays, because a lot of cases of dengue are happening in various cities. So that is the sort of initiatives that government has come up with. I agree to all the points that you have mentioned, and I believe they are all in the favor of what we want to see India as. So this economic survey also said that the total health expenditure that India has in as a percentage of GDP is approximately 4.7. So that has increased from the previous figures. And we also know that the per capita health expenditure by the government has also been increased to say $287 this year. So I believe India is moving in the right direction, and I totally agree to all the points that have been put here. And so a lot of things have been talked about, and I would say that almost 62% of deaths in India annually happen due to non-communicable diseases. So the scenario is changing now from the infectious diseases to the non-communicable diseases, and government has been successful enough to address issues in that area. So that is about a part of what we want to talk in terms of health in this economic survey. That is all from my side. Yeah.
Moving on to the state level analysis for DALIS, which is Disability Adjusted Life Years, As per research, states which have high life expectancy, they reflect lower on the Dallas rates, meaning there are lower incidence of diseases and vice versa. Now, even though the National Health Policy 2017 has been introduced and it recommends increasing the state sector health spending to more than 8% of the state government budget by 2020, there's a need to understand whether high spending by states could result in better health outcomes or not. So as per the data by per capita public health expenditure for 2015 and 2016, it can be seen that states which have lower per capita per health public health expenditure, they reflect higher on the Dallas rates and vice versa. Moving to combating antimicrobial resistance in India, as per WHO's report, AMR, which is antimicrobial resistance, it's a particular concern for countries like India, which are developing nations, because the burden of infectious diseases is relatively high and the healthcare spending is pretty low. On one hand, antibiotics are seen as necessary for many life-threatening cures, but on the other hand, overuse of antibiotics could be disastrous for a nation in the long run. Hence, the antibiotics need to be judiciously used. And India has taken a step ahead in this regard because it has finalized a comprehensive national action plan, which is in alignment with the global action plan. And the objectives of the plan are to enhance the awareness regarding AMR, to improve the rational use of antibiotics, to reduce infections, and also to promote research in this area. Moving on to a different topic, the health of the population, we know that it's very closely related to the quality of life that the people have, like whether they have access to proper sanitation facilities or not, whether they have access to safe drinking water or not, because this can decrease the disease burden on the population. And hence our Prime Minister, he launched the Swachh Bharat Mission on 2nd October 2014. In this regard, we see that there has been a significant decline in the number of people who defecate openly in rural areas, because so far close to 300 districts and 3 lakh villages have been declared open defecation free, which is ODF. Also, as per a pilot study which was undertaken by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation in certain select ODF and non-ODF areas, the non-ODF districts, they reflect higher on the percent population with diarrhea, with stunting, very lower BMI, while there is a low percentage population with secondary education. On the other hand, it's the very opposite for ODF areas, where there is a high percentage of people with secondary education. And the behavior of individuals has shifted because of the proactive work which has been undertaken by the village committees, village health and sanitation committees. So to conclude, towards inclusion development, India has been implementing various policies, various programs for social sectors like education, health for women and the marginalized sections of the society, so that the gaps between education attainment, employment opportunities, health outcomes is being bridged. Also, though macroeconomic growth and efficient markets are essential, it is even necessary to equally ensure that the benefits of growth are equitably accessible to all the citizens to make growth much more broad-based.
We see that, you know, now how the things are moving up. We need to empower the women in the society also, yeah? So that thing is very important. And we see that the high pedestal that's available for them to be able to channelize that to the whole of the society is the parliament itself. Yeah, we see that the representation, women representation in parliaments in different countries such as South Africa and Rwanda. Rwanda is also almost 60%.
Yeah, in India, our stats is like our Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, the women representatives are only around 11%.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which is very low. In some states like Bihar and Haryana, it's around 14%. So it's a bit high, but still comparatively, Rwanda, Mexico,
South Africa,
and which is around 40, as you just said. So it's like uncomparable. The level is, you know, too far. And like, let's talk about economic wise. As we said, Germany is one of the, you know, highest GDP of the countries, and
they have the German chancellor, Angela Merkel.
They have the leader as a female. So we should be able to see that we need to empower women so that, you know, our economy is boosted.
So as we are talking about the empowerment of women and their representation in the politics, so the Indian politics I consider is mostly male dominated, and the reason why women are not able to enter is the reason of the Indian mentality that we have. No man would want to sit at home and take care of the family and the children and the other stuff, that the household things that we have to do. But they consider only women to do that. So one of the factors that leads to this problem is that the household activities that the women have to do. Apart from that, the lack of finance that the women have, they don't have access to that much of finance. Any parent would want their sons to go ahead. They would not want to invest in their daughters. So the lack of finance, the money available for the girl child to educate her, to be educated, that is also not enough. Apart from that, the lack of confidence and the support from the family, these are the few factors that that are responsible for less representation of women in politics and workforce.
Yes, but we have a few examples like Nirmala Sitharaman, the defense minister of our country, and Sushma Swaraj as well. She is the external affairs minister of our country. So yeah, women are taking, women are, they are holding good ministries in the cabinet. And even we have examples like Mrs. Bhakti Sharma in my state. She is the head of the Gram Panchayat. So on the rural scale also, we are now building on that.
Yeah, let's talk about the Gram Panchayat. We see that in our country now, it's a law in almost all of the states that at least 1/3 of the members in the panchayat should be women. Yeah,
yes.
And at the higher level, the leader of the panchayat has to be women, 1/3 of it. Yeah. But we see that even more than that, women are also acquiring positions that seats that are not reserved for them. So that means that from that perspective, women are holding a very good position because they are able to channelize what is existing at the ground level to the development that they want to bring about.
One thing I would like to add is that when we talk about women empowerment, the government had launched Maternity Benefit Act, which has increased the maternity leave for 26 weeks.
Okay.
Now I believe that government should have also enhanced the Paternity Leave Act. I mean, why should the care of the child be left for mother only? I mean, why should it be her burden also? Even we fathers have some duty towards our children.
Yeah,
so the government should have done that. Secondly, the Indian population is 49% of the Indian population consists of women. So the government should have should try to have adequate representation of women to cater for that 49% of the population. Because women are able to connect more, they have better emotional intelligence, they are able to be more compassionate, and as you said earlier, they have a better ground reality.
I would want to touch the topic of education of women. The literacy level, according to the census, was 73%, and the female is only 64%. And the reason is the dropouts of women. And that also, the point of sanitation and the other Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, we say, that has also encouraged women to study more.
And also, other government initiatives like we have Mahila Shakti Kendra, which is a leadership development and addressing women's issues problem. So the government has taken steps, still we are still seeing this backwardness regarding the politics or the state of the country. So what can we, attribute this to? Maybe it's the society, the mentality of the society.
Yeah, therefore I'm coming to that point. First we need to change the mentality of the people. We need to change the mindset of the people. Recently the Indian parents have one thought that often they continue to have children until they have the desired number of sons. Therefore they want to have the baby boy. They want to have.
And then there is also a law that exists that prevents scanning of children, so that prevents the female foresight that especially exists in the states which are a little lower in the child sex ratio, and that is heavily skewed towards the male society.
Yeah,
also talking about that factor of women empowerment, We also see that if there are 49% of the women that is part of the population, that is not translating into how we are seeing their representation in labor, in education, yeah, and in the higher representation in the state level, yeah, or in the country as a whole. So in order to bring about that transformation, let's talk about more about the health partners also, yeah. We see that the health as a sector as a whole is mostly skewed towards the private and not the public, because you know there's a lot of out-of-pocket expenditure that exists because the infrastructure from the government side is a lot of, I mean, it's very poor, especially at the PHC level. Yeah.
So the health, if we talk about health basically relates to the drinking water and the sanitation facilities and the environment around us. So the basic level. So another scheme I would want to talk about is the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan that came into existence since 2nd of October in 2014. So that has contributed a lot in all these aspects, and that has also promoted the health of the people.
Yeah, talking about health, we have health centers, sub-centers in rural places. But the thing is, they don't have good doctors sometimes. And their duty hours is very low. For example, they might start working from 11 in the morning and then go back by 3 p.m. or something. So their availability is also in question. And also, like, if there's only one doctor, and if suppose that doctor is on leave, who will be there? So we need more manpower, more educated power in the rural
centers. As Casey is talking about the less availability of doctors in the rural areas, not just doctors but anyone, if they are investing so much in their education, they would not want to go to some rural village and work there. They would only want higher packages, as we do expect that. And working in MNCs, nobody would want to go back to a village and work there for very less wages. So that is also a mentality that we have, and there is lack of skilled, formally skilled people and in the workforce. So I would want to come to this point that the skilling of youth is really important, as well as the formally skilled people in India are just 2%. Whereas if we see that ratio in South Korea, it is 96%, and in Japan it's 80%. So this is also really important.
I would like to add some statistics which presents a dark side of India relating to health. Because of lack of sanitation, there have been at least 1 million deaths, stunting 48% children, mostly from the rural areas. And 63% Indians were pushed into catastrophic health expenditure, as per 2015 Government of India's report. So if you see that the health situation in our country is really bad, and also this government has increased its budget regarding the health, but we still need to see whether those policies are really implemented.
The budget recently came out with a scheme where the families would be, I think 5 crore families would be given access to tertiary level of accessibility to hospitals. Yeah. But we also see that the infrastructure that exists at the ground level is not very up to mark to meet the level of healthcare that is needed by those families. Yeah. And that also channelizes to how we move up to the secondary and tertiary level of health access. We have very few institutions such as AIMS that are able to cater to this. It has such a huge, lack of facilities to cater to that amount of, it has facilities, but the amount of queues that it has to cater to that population is too huge for all those people to have access to the tertiary health care.
So basically you're saying that the family planning method should be used much more, because so that we are able to curb the population, so it has a better access to health care, education, employment opportunities.
Yeah, so all these sum up to human development.
Yeah.
And we must invest in our human resources, and the human resource becomes human capital. And investment in the human capital is a prerequisite. And the priority should be education and skilling, skill development and health. So I would want to come upon the point that Human Development Index. It is an index that, and it has three parameters. Basically, the first one is the long and healthy life of people. The second is education and knowledge. And the third is the standard of living of people. This index has 187 countries, and India's rank is 135th. And it is like the last of the BRICS countries. So that's just India is before Bangladesh and Pakistan. So this is also human development is really required.
And also I would like to add the happiness index as well in that. So human development, it has to be, you know, all around development.
Yes.
So happiness index should also be increased, as we all know that the happiness index of India is fairly
even low. Government of Sikkim introduces new department called happiness department, and that was really quite initiative from this government, and it is appreciated all over the country.
Yeah, the government of Madhya Pradesh actually introduced that department. And what happened actually over time is that the happiness index that you're talking about, it was first introduced in Bhutan. As a country, it's very progressive because it's catering to the all over dimension that involves the human. And we see that there is a talk about the fact that now how the development and the competition that exists between the countries and the societies is not going to be for the resources, because almost everybody has now access to the same amount of resources. But one resource that is going to change the dimensions how we compete on is the human resource. Yeah. So this topic or this thing is social infrastructure is actually built around an environment about the human, around the human and the population that is coming up the ladder, so that it is capable enough to be able to channelize its energy for the better development of the country and better development of the society as a whole. So as a change, it would have to start from us, and obviously, as Gandhi said, the change starts from you, and then it translates to your home, and then how it translates to the country and the world as well.